world records of 45.94 and 51.46 by Carson Varhom and Sydney McLaughlin, respectively, have set a new paradigm for the 400-meter hurdles in the sport of track and field. Today, we discuss with Lennox Graham, the assistant coach at Clemson University, what that means for some of our Caribbean elite athletes. Graham coaches Kyron McMaster, Leah Nugent, and of course, Danielle Williams in the sport of track and field. And of course, he joins us now to talk about the significance of what we saw at the Olympic Games this past summer. Lennox, thanks for joining us on Point. Of course, it was a fantastic Olympic Games. We saw some earth-shifting performances from Kyron McMaster, of course, 47.08. Of course, the world record 45.94 by Carsten Varhom, and of course, 51.46 from Sydney McLaughlin. From a coaching perspective, what do those times mean to you?
Well, Leighton, first of all, thanks for having me. Yes, it was purely earth-shifting, the performances that we saw in Tokyo, especially in the one lap over the hurdles, eh? Carsten won home 45.9. We did not see that coming. Well, I did not see that coming. Sydney McLaughlin breaking the world record, I kind of saw that coming. But what it means for us is that we have to think about the event a little bit differently. The event is always going to be a rhythm event. The event was always one where you had fairly good quarter milers who are running in the event, and so safely, with a differential between the 400 meters and the 400 hurdle time of anywhere between 1.5 and, let's say, 3 seconds. You would expect that if your athlete ran a certain time, certainly 47.08, you would expect that they would be coming back with a medal. Of course, the reality is that was good for fourth place, number 8 all time, but for fourth place, would have probably medaled at every other Olympics and won at quite a few others. But it is what it is. So what it means for us is that we have to realize that unless we have someone like our illustrious Dr. Neil Gardner, who for most of his career had a 400-meter hurdle PB that was faster than his 400 PB, we're just going to have to bring some better quarter milers to the event or encourage the ones who have come there, why they have to explain to them why they have to be better 400-meter runners in order to be successful in this era of the 400-meter hurdles, men and women.
All right, 47.08, by the way, would have won in every year except for 1992 and, of course, this past Olympic Games.
Yes.
So that puts us in some greater context. But from a coaching perspective, of course, you mentioned that, you know, there has to be a rethink. What does that mean? What does that look like in terms of training, in terms of nutrition, in terms of just the general practice to get, you know, get to that level where you're able to break 47 as consistently as we've seen from Varhom and, of course, you know, Ry Benjamin and others who have taken the sport, the discipline, to a new level?
Well, the most important thing, I think, Leighton, is a mindset change. You have to adjust. You know, it's like in any other sport. When Mike Tyson ruled the roost and nobody thought he was beatable, and then once he got beat once, then all of a sudden every opponent thought they had a chance. So it's the same kind of a situation now where the athlete and the coach has to review their whole mindset. Because if it is that you were targeting low 47, for example, in order to be there or thereabouts on the podium, then obviously that's not good enough. So we have to rethink how we design the targets that we set during practice. Of course, there is the talent level. You have to be able to run for the men, for example, at least 45.5 or faster in order to be very competitive at this level. If your aim is to get a medal, then obviously you have to try to be that competitive. Like I said, you do have the anomaly, the odd person who will run almost as fast on the flat and over the hurdles, but history has shown us that those don't come along very often. So the same thing on the women's side. If you look at the people who are chaining, the young ladies who are trading the world record, it's a 48 split and a 49 split in the 4x4s. And I dare say probably 49, both of them could be sub 49 or sub 50, at least in the 400. So that's where the event is at the moment. And if you want to be competitive at that event, then you have to try to get there. If you can't get there, based on just sheer talent, the best you could do is, let's say, 51. Then you have to find a way to really almost decrease to zero that differential between your 400 hurdles and your 400 meter time.
Danny McFarlane was one of those unique athletes who he ran 48 flat, a personal best. Of course, it's still outside of Winthrop Graham's record that was set way back in 1993. With what you're suggesting, are we then to believe that we could be seeing some 44 guys eventually from the Caribbean, if there are any, because we haven't seen many of them in the last few years, switch to the 400 meter hurdles as an opportunity, given that they already possess some of those qualities you just mentioned?
It could be. First of all, with Danny McFarlane was awesome, represented Jamaica very well. Danny McFarlane, if you remember, was a 44 quarter mile. Mm-hmm. I dare say if Danny McFarlane had a better hurdling technique, he would be the record holder for the Jamaican 400 meter hurdles, because he did have that potential to run very low 47 if he would have been able to get that rhythm part of the race down, or the hurdling part of the race to assist the rhythm down. But yes, we haven't seen that many 44 quarter milers come out of the Caribbean. But what we have to know that right now, that the 400 meter runners who are 46 seconds and trying to come to trials to make a 4x4 would be probably better suited of trying to run 45 and going to the 400 meter hurdles. The 400 hurdle coaches who have 400 hurdlers now from the Caribbean have to start at least finding a way to help get those hurdlers down to 44 seconds in the 400 if they're going to be able to make a decent living, a career out of these events.
Let's get a little bit more specific now. You coach Kyron McMaster, the best athlete from the Caribbean in the event, 47.08, a brand new national record for the BVI, a massive personal best down from his 47.50. You know, right. What was his mindset following that remarkable race where he finished fourth in 47.08? Was it a situation where he was thinking, what do I have to do next, given how well he ran and the winning time?
You know what? That's a very interesting question. Kyron, believe it or not, at the start of the year, was losing interest in the sport. He really was. And at one point in time, I told him, I would not be surprised if you ran 47.0. And you told me that this would have been it for the year, because he was just not interested that much anymore. We were pushing for quite a while this year to just regain the interest. I was in Tokyo, as you know, with the British Virgin Islands team, and he did a local interview with someone from the BVI. And he, before the race, was saying he didn't know where this came from, but he's had a new level of interest for, you know, track and field now, and he is really going to be more serious over the next 4 or 5 years. Of course, that was a shocker to me coming to the Olympics. I thought this was going to be it for Kyron McMaster. So having run 47.0 and getting fourth place, I immediately thought, oh, I'm not sure how he's going to respond to this, because just getting the interest and the vibe back, and then all of a sudden you run 47.0 and not medal, this probably is going to turn him off. But the opposite happened. He realized, he came back saying, coach, our mindset have to be different. We can't go through a career trying to be a finalist. We want to be a medalist. And so it gave him an increased amount of passion and impetus just to go forward and identify areas that he has to work on. Because, of course, by his own admission, his off the track was not necessarily the best, because he was losing interest. Not that he was, you know, all over the place, because he wasn't all over the place. But he saw that was where he could make a bit of improvement, because he wants to be a medalist. And so it's great for a coach to know that you have an athlete now who has a more drive for excellence in his or her discipline. And it should make my job a little bit easier than it was for the past year or so.
When you look back at his race, the fourth place finish, 47.08, one of the fastest times in history, did you detect weaknesses, areas where he could improve upon that will get him below that 47-second barrier? And if so, what would some of those changes require, you know, be required in the offseason coming up?
Well, for one, you know, we have been working at getting him into a better 400 meter runner over the past 2 years. Sometimes Leighton, people put a quarter of 400 hurdle coach in a box and say he's a hurdle coach, but not recognizing that the biggest contributor to that final time is actually the 400. So we have been working at getting him to be a better 400 meter runner over the last couple of seasons. He's run 45 in the 400 indoors. We haven't really run the 400 meter outdoors part of that due to, you know, little niggles that happen throughout anybody's career. And so you want to be safe and get ready for the targeted meets down in May, June, July. So we haven't really run him in a lot of 400s, but the idea is to get him better at the 400. And that would definitely get him better at the 400 hurdles. In the race itself, the Olympic final, actually at the Olympics, he ran injured. So he was fortunate. God was good. He was fortunate to not get a very, very challenging prelim or a very, very challenging semi. Most people would say that semifinal was the easiest of the three. He obviously qualified from both the mid 40, 48 and low 48. So the first time he really had to go pedal to metal was the 400 hurdles final. But when you watch the race, he was pretty much in and around fourth place in the first half of the race. But leaving the 200, he was solely in third. And he made a mistake at hurdle 7. And after hurdle 7, he was in fifth position. So he had to finish a little bit stronger than he normally would. But it taught him something about himself, because I think that was the first time he would have run by Samba in any race. And so having made that mistake in the middle of the top turn and still coming back to run 47.0, it's encouraging for him mentally that he definitely has the potential. Now, we know that the time you actually run has to do a lot with not only potential, but the environment at the time, and everything has to be right. So we won't see 45 every day, nor will we see everybody at 46 every day, but he does have the potential to run sub 47 seconds.
Well, based on what you just said, obviously. Does the same apply to Leah Nugent? Because, I mean, she's been there. Well, she was in the finals of the World Championships in 2017. Not so fortunate in 2019, of course. Bowed out early again at the Olympics this year. You know, do the same dynamics apply to her?
Absolutely. Absolutely applies to Leah. Leah was injured for most of last year. So she missed quite a bit of work. In the late background to early outdoor season. So whereas we were able to get Leah to 54, high 54, and make the national team, which we were grateful to make the national team, it wasn't easy to keep her going up towards the end of the season. So we have to find a way to have Leah be more, be healthier during the entire season, especially all background and early, late indoor coming into outdoor. We have to have her healthy. The same approach applies, trying to get her to be a better 400 runner. She's run 52 indoors before. So obviously we have to try to get her back to a low 52 or high 51 indoors. And then the 400 hurdle will improve from there. She got DQ'd in the Olympic Games for a lane violation. So that's something we have to be looking at also. When I looked at all the pictures, I couldn't find the lane violation. But when I saw a video, which she actually sent to me, we saw where she actually had a lane violation. So the approach is going to be the same, better 400 meters and to make some adjustment as far as her hurdling is concerned.
All right. So let's switch gears to the shorter version of the hurdles now, the 100 and 110 meter hurdles, where Jamaica, it seems, is getting deeper in this event each year. The reigning Olympic champion before the national champion, just Omar McLeod, of course, didn't make the team. And many people, especially here at home, didn't believe we had a shot at a medal at the Olympic Games, but we came back with a gold and bronze medal, of course, and we had three people in the final. When we look around as well, we see the likes of Orlando Bennett and, you know, Lemonius from, I think it was Arkansas, he attends. You know, we're seeing a deeper field for the 110-meter hurdles for men. Is this an indication, you think, that you might start seeing a shift from the more celebrated 100 meters to this sprint hurdles event, given the talent that we've seen emerging over the past 6-7 years, especially with the talent that has come to the fore now, you know, in 2021, of course, looking going forward?
Well, the short answer is at home from Jamaica, I don't think so, because we are so sprint crazy. We are all about the 100 and the 200 meters. And we do have some people who would be better suited for other events, who have the speed, world-class speed, for example, for other events. But we are so obsessed with the 100 meters and the 200 meters. And it's so weird for me, because just thinking about it, I'm an extremely logical guy, and you're in this for a career, and you're in the career to make money as an athlete in a small window, which is closing every single day and every single year. And last time I checked, they paid the same amount for first place in the shot put, discus, 100, 200, 1500, mile, 3000, 5K, whatever. And so I don't know what is the obsession with all that, why we can't shake that. But we need to. The sprint hurdles on both sides, as you said, is becoming extremely deep. And it's going to be one of the harder events to make. So I don't know, because of that, if it's an encouragement for more people to go towards it, or for more people to say, hey, I'm safe over here making the relay pool and the 100 or the 400. So that's how I look at it. I wish more people would go towards it. But of course, it's three people, maximum four, in a world championship year that will make the individual hurdle event. While you might have a situation where I've seen before where eight people in the 100 make the relay pool, or seven people in the 400 make the relay pool. So that probably is what going to probably keep people away from, you know, migrating to, let's say, the hurdle event, because the opportunities are becoming less and less. When you have the reigning Olympic champion, Omar McLeod, not making the Olympic team, unfortunate events, but he didn't make it. And we still ended up with two medals. Then, you know, that already tells you how deep that event is going to be. And I promise you that every year, you're going to see some new people coming up, because the young Thomas did not have a good NCAA championship result, but he just bounced back and came back and made the Olympic team. And like you said, people like Orlando was there, and so on, a couple others, Lamonius and a couple others, who were just there or thereabouts. Mm-hmm. So basically, that event is going to probably have some 13-4 people or so not making the final in the near future, which is awesome for the sport, but not so awesome for the individuals who are thinking about it. So if you have, for example, that guy who could run 13-4, but he could probably run 10-1, then he might want to take his chance at the 4x1 rather than the hurdles, if you understand what I'm saying.
Yeah, I'm getting it. Because the thing is, I mean, what we've seen since the retirement of Usain Bolt is that the 100 meters has come back a little bit. I mean, guys are still running 9.7s, but most of the Jamaican male sprinters these days are struggling to break 10 seconds flat, which puts them outside of the window of medal opportunity at major events. But
yeah, it's just interesting to hear you say that's come back a little bit. Guys are running 9.7s.
Yeah, it just tells you where Usain Bolt took it, because 9.58, yes. And you had Tyson Gears running 9.71, you had Blake 9.69. You know,
right.
They took it to a level where 9.8 looks ordinary now. So, you know, we have to get back used to that, those ordinary times in the coming years. But let me turn your attention to the women's side of things, because your child, Danielle Williams, had a challenging year with injury. Of course, Megan Tapper went on to the Olympic Games and created her own history by becoming the first Caribbean woman to win a medal in the 100-meter hurdles at the Olympics.
Awesome.
Talk to me a little bit about that event, given the depth that we see there, including your own Danielle Williams, who briefly this year before an injury, 12:50 again, showing that had she been healthy, she may very well have been among the medals in Tokyo.
Well, first of all, congratulations to Megan and her handlers. Excellent job. Not only that she got that bronze medal, Lynn, but she also showed up running mid-12s a couple of times, which is huge for her. I've known Megan for a very long time, never coached her, but I've known her for a very long time. And it showed a lot of grit and determination to go through the ups and downs that she has gone through. But again, that's just an example of life. And we could look on parchment and say what he has gone through too. So it's a message to the people who are out there looking for a quick fix that is not necessarily so, and don't give up too early. But to Danielle, yeah, she struggled with some injuries this year. It was tough to watch. Tough to be a part of, because as you know, she also did not make the 2016 Olympic Games. She got too close to a hurdle and had to bail out of that race. So it's been two Olympic Olympiads now that she has not made it. So that was very, very tough on her. Injuries are a part of the game, but for her and anybody else in her corner, they'll be like, why in the Olympic year? We don't get to choose. You know, we have to just manage what the cards that we are dealt, and we got her back enough to be, and the plan was really to run the last three races, Paris, Brussels, and Zurich, and hopefully get a chance at being an automatic qualifier for the next world championship. It wasn't to be. Ran 12:50, best technical race of the year, started looking like her old self, and then all of a sudden in Brussels, she just got hurt early in the race. Was a little disappointed that she didn't stop. And she ended up continuing hurdling, so she made it a little bit worse than it could have been. But then it's the competitive nature. It's easy for the coach to say, hey, you felt something, you should stop your experience. But when you are competing, you never want to feel like this is it. You know, you feel like you can still listen and try and see if it will go away. And then, you know, you end up kind of making it worse. So it was a tough year for her. We're into the off season. Got treated, doing our rehabs right now. Hopefully we'll be able to get back started sometime in October. But it was a tough season for her, the toughest since she has been a professional. But again, the depth of that event in Jamaica is awesome. If you think about it, we had a 12-4 young lady, Brown, who did not show up last year at all.
Johnny Brown,
her talent has gone nowhere. It's still there. So she will be back, hopefully. You know, for the sake of herself and the nation, that she'll be back. We also have the youngsters running 12.5, 12.4, you know, so we have at least two 12.4, 12.3, 12.5 as PBs in the Jamaican women's sprint hurdles. And I, as with any other event, you do look out for somebody else to make that breakthrough, because we do have some others in 12.6, 12.7s, and 12.8s, you know, so... I remember a year when we came to the national trials with Shermaine Williams, and nobody at that point in time had made the qualifying time. And by the end of the prelims, we had like three or four people running 12.8, 12.9. And we were like, yeah, we have people who qualify. We don't have to wait like that anymore. You know, they've already qualified for the next major game. So it's now going to be almost like the US, where they say the USA sprint hurdles women is the hardest team to make. They are this event to make in the world. I dare say Jamaica has now kind of taken up where that the US left off, because in the top 10 in the world, in terms of time, we probably going to have as many people as they have, as the US have in the top 10 in the world. So it's going to be interesting, and it's going to be about who gets it right at the right time. It's not going to be about who's better than who.
I couldn't let you go without asking you your impressions of what we saw in the Olympics from Elaine Thompson, Hera Sherika Jackson, of course, Shelly-Ann Fraser-Pryce. Never in the history of the sport have three women run under 10.8 in a final Olympic Games. For a nation our size, Lennox, and for somebody who's coached some of the best athletes in the world, from the high school level through to the collegiate level, what did you make of what you saw in Tokyo from our women, especially?
You know what? I have been... at it with some of those youngsters, and I call them youngsters because of my age, no disrespect to them, from the time they were high schoolers all the way up. I remember feeling so privileged and grateful to be around during the Usain Bolt era to say, yeah, I was there at that time. But these three ladies, and especially what Sherika was able to do, coming down from the 400 and coming down to the 100, 200 and doing it so well, so consistently, obviously not as technically practiced as the other two. I really rate her season a lot. What Elaine was able to do, man, that is out of the atmosphere. Shelly, we know what we get from Shelly, and we always will be proud of Shelly. And Shelly is our champion, our former national record holder, but we will not take anything away from Elaine, what she was able to do. And the most impressive thing to me about Elaine's performance was really whatever her coach did to fix her start after having been working at it for so long and it wasn't getting there. Whatever he did to make that click, not as consistent, like he said, as he would like, but her start was amazing in terms of in the final. And she was much more consistent at it now than she was before. So it's just a privilege to watch that, to watch three young ladies from the same country dominate like that. Of course, we do want the competition. I am one of those who would like to see somebody come up from another country to really challenge, because that's a part of our sport. Being a born Jamaican, you have your bias, but basically I would love to see someone come up to challenge, or people come up to challenge them, and it is there. We have people showing up in the 200. We have people who've shown up briefly in the 100 and will be back to show up. So it's just good for the continued life of our sport. Mm-hmm.
And finally, what's the mood like at Clemson these days? Now that the school has reversed its decision to continue with the track program that was supposed to have ended this past season, because as the school claimed through financial concerns or constraints. Now that they've reversed that decision, you know, what's the mood like at Clemson these days, Mark Elliott and yourself, and of course the athletes?
Well, personally, my move is their miracles still do happen, you know, because we were almost sure that this was going to be irreversible. We were told that it was going to be irreversible. So when this happened, of course, the mood is great. The mood is great. What last year did was to bring the team so much closer together. I was telling someone earlier today that I found myself encouraging some of my student athletes to say, listen, you have to get in the portal. You have to look out for yourself. Don't worry about the coach, because the coach has to find a way to take care of himself. The coach will not be able to take care of 15 athletes if the program, or 10 athletes if the program is kind of done. And people were almost refusing to go in the portal, and just the love they have for the school, the university, and the drive to keep the family together was amazing, and it's going to result. It resulted in a top 20 performance by the men team at the NCAA Outdoor Championship, which under the mental stresses that we were under, some of it you could not imagine. It was amazing. For me, it was like winning a national championship for the guys to get in the top 20. So with that year behind us, and some of them coming back, we've lost a couple, but some of them coming back, then we're praying that we can have a solid season again and even top that performance that we did last year.
Well, wishing you all the best, Lennox Graham. Thank you so much for joining us for On Point this week. And we're wishing you and Clemson all the best. Mark Elliott, I used to watch him running at champs. That 5,000 meter could never run out of steam, it seems. And of course, now he's doing it at Clemson as a coach. So thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure, man. It's a privilege. Thank you for having me.
Take it easy. That's it for this week for On Point.